Today we're looking at living on the edge of protection. How many of you have heard the saying, God won't give you any more than you can handle? Everybody heard that? Isn't that great? Guess what? It's a myth. God is going to give you more than you can handle. Think about it. If He never gave you as an individual more than you can handle, and He never gave the church more than we could handle, where would He ever get His glory from? Other than the fact that He is worthy of glory, and He is glory. But if I'm doing what I can handle, I'm not bringing glory to God. But when I allow, when He puts me in a situation that it is more than I can handle, and I have to depend on Him, He gets the glory for it. So there's a lot of those myths out there like that. There's another one that we hear. Sometimes we get the idea, and people say, well, if you're right in the center of God's will, then you'll be totally safe. I don't know about you, but there have been times in my life that I've looked at it and I said, without a doubt, I know I'm right in the middle of God's will. But I felt like I was living on the edge of God's protection. There have been some close calls. Know what I mean? You ever felt like you were, and you just knew that you knew that you knew that you were right where God wanted you to be, doing what God wanted you to do, and life wasn't safe? It was a dangerous place to be. As a matter of fact, I can't remember right now who wrote the book, but it's entitled Dangerous Calling, and it's for ministers, about the dangerous calling of ministry. Tremendous book about the fact that we're called to live on the edge of protection. So today we're going to look at these three chapters. It describes David's life and portions of his life, and we want to see what it is like and how David lived in the edge of protection. I want us to pay attention to the attributes of David that we see here. And I think we see three attributes in his life as he lives in the edge of protection. And I think they're all three very important for us to live and to remember that just because the situation looks tough, we have to live with these attributes in our life. The first attribute I see is that of humility. David's humility. I mean, first of all, think of how difficult it is to know that you have been, by God's design, the next king. As a matter of fact, you have been anointed as king. But there's another king in place right now. There's somebody in that position, so you don't get to take over that position yet. You're kind of the anointed king in waiting. Tough place to be. David knows in his heart the direction that God has for him. God's already shown him that. God has anointed him by his prophet. So we see in David's life great humility as he awaits that position. We don't find David going, hey, you know what? Let me tell you what happened last weekend at the house. Samuel showed up, all my brothers were pushed aside, and guess what? I'm the next king. We do see a guy in the Bible that did something like that. His name was Joseph. God gave him a vision and showed him what was coming and what was ahead. And what did he do? He went in and told his dad and his brothers what was going on. That worked well for him, right? They chucked him in a pit and sold him as a slave. So David used wisdom here. He didn't start announcing the fact, and he didn't start exploiting the fact that he was the king that was going to be in this position in the short time. Look at 1 Samuel chapter 18, verses 1 through 4. It says, when David had finished speaking with Saul, Jonathan was bound to David in close friendship and loved him as much as he loved himself. Saul kept David with him from that day on and did not let him return to his father's house. Jonathan made a covenant with David because he loved him as much as himself. And when Jonathan removed the, and then Jonathan removed the robe he was wearing, gave it to David along with his military tunic, his sword, his bow, and his belt. See, there was this friendship that's already beginning to develop. There's this, Jonathan is the rightful heir to the throne, if you look at the way it should pass from the king to his son and so forth. But Jonathan is now committing his friendship, committing his loyalty to David, and it's not because David is going to be the next king. Jonathan doesn't know that yet. Saul knows that God has removed his hand from him, but he doesn't know at this point who he's placed his hand on. And so Jonathan is responding and is basing this commitment to David on friendship, not on kingship. And David accepts and responds to this friendship with humility. You don't find, literally, if you read every verse in here, you would find David responding with tears. There is humility in the fact that I'm not worthy. I'm not worthy. And I know that under the normal succession, he would be the one, but I'm the one, but our friendship is there and we love each other and we're going to be there for each other. Next, we see that David doesn't play it safe. He marches out with the army into battle. He doesn't try to pull rank. Wait a minute, do you know who I'm supposed to be? Do you know the position I'm supposed to have? As a matter of fact, in this day, the king should be leading the army. Remember that when we get to another event in David's life later on. But David, without question, moves out with the army. He fights with the army, and God gives him great success on the battlefield, and David is promoted in rank very quickly, not because of the position he has coming, but because of the work that he's doing, the humility and the obedience to God. The custom of the day was that when the victorious army would return home, there would be a parade and dancing and singing in the streets. It would be party time. And we see that taking place. And in chapter 18, verse 7, it says, speaking of that time, it says, and they danced. As they danced, the women sang, Saul has killed his thousands, but David his 10,000s. The people were already beginning to see that there was something about David. There was something great about David. And this infuriates Saul. But there's no indication in the scripture that it puffed David up. David seemed to respond to this with humility. It didn't make him prideful. He was okay to enter the palace because as he came in, this war hero, now he comes in and the first thing you see he's doing is he's back in there playing his little guitar, whatever a lyre is. He's playing this stringed instrument to calm Saul down. I don't know about you, but that seems to me like a demotion from being a mighty warrior. He's the music guy. No offense, guys. But when you think of a mighty warrior, you don't think of the guy with the harp. So he's in humility doing what God has called him to do and told him to do and what his role is, and that is play your music for the king. And the king got angrier day after day. We even see David's humility in his attitude toward Mary and Saul's daughter. Remember the promise? To the man that defeats Goliath, he gets my daughter. Saul had two daughters. Look at chapter 18, verse 17 through 19. Saul told David, here's my oldest daughter, Merib, and I'll give her to you as a wife if you will be a warrior for me and fight the Lord's battles. Now, I don't know about you, but the first thing I thought about, wait a minute, wasn't the promise I will give her to you if you defeat Goliath? David's already done what Saul said he had to do to get his daughter. But now Saul changes the game. He ups the ante. Oh yeah, yeah, you did do that, but if you will continue to fight in the army and you will fight in the Lord's army, then I will give you my daughter. Saul told David, here's my oldest daughter, Merib. I'll give her to you as a wife if you will be a warrior for me and fight the Lord's battle. But Saul was thinking, I don't need to raise a hand against him. Remember, Saul's angry. David's getting all the praise and all the glory. I don't need to raise a hand against him. Let the hand of the Philistines be against him. Then David responded, who am I? And what is my family or my father's clan in Israel that I should become the king's son-in-law? When it was time to give Saul's daughter Merib to David, she was given to Adriel, the Maathite, as a wife. Got shafted again, didn't he? Notice David didn't refuse her. He didn't say, no, Saul, I don't want her. I don't want your daughter. He never said that. He just said, who am I? The humility just bleeds there. How is it that I deserve this? I'm a nobody from a family of nobodies, and who am I? Where Saul reneges on his word and he gives his daughter to someone else. Notice the humility. See it coming out in multiple instances, multiple events in the life of David here? And that's the point. That if we want to remain in the will of God, we have to remain humble. It's not about us. It's not about bringing glory to us. It's about bringing glory to God. Remember, that's the reason he bowed up and he fought against Goliath, is for the glory of God. He was dealing with defending the honor of God, not himself. And even as a hero, David still has this humility about him. And I think that holds him in the will of God and on the edge of protection. Because everything's not going great in his life right now. He's winning some battles, but the deals that were being made with him, the rules are being changed, and David is drawing the short stick every time. But he was humble. The second thing I see here is that David was obedient. He went in and he played his musical instrument to calm a king that despised him. Saul hated him. He didn't get angry when the king gave his oldest daughter to another man. He just kept on being obedient to what God wanted him to do, and that was to serve the king. Don't you know it's got to be tough to serve a king that you know God's removed his hand from? God said, it's not going to be Saul anymore, it's going to be David, and David knew that. And yet he had to keep playing and calming this angry king that hated him and that really God had removed his hand from. When Saul did give him his daughter, his second daughter, Michal, there was a thing to be dealt with, and that was the bride price. You know, when I married Jerry, I did go to her dad and ask for her hand in marriage, and after a speech, you'd have to know Jerry's dad to appreciate this one, but a long speech. Don't have a clue what he said, okay? But it was a long speech. But he gave me permission. I tease her now and tell her, honestly, I'm the only guy you ever dated that your dad ever liked. But the custom in that day was you got to pay something for the bride. There's this bride price. Now, when I think about David and Michael and the fact that there's this discussion of bride price, hasn't he already paid for it twice? Saul didn't say anything about a bride price. He said, if you kill Goliath, you get my daughter. If you fight in the army, you get my daughter. Saul had two. One's gone because he gave it to someone else. Now here's Michael getting ready. Well, there's this bride price. Now he was gracious. He didn't require David to come in with gold and silver and precious stones. David couldn't afford that. He was a poor boy, a poor young man from a poor family. They didn't have the means. How on earth would they ever come up with what it would cost to have the right to marry the king's daughter? Saul said, I'll make you a deal. No silver, no gold. But there is a price. Now, this is the PG version. If you don't understand why I'm saying that, go back and read this later, okay? Let me just say this. It wasn't a monetarily expensive price that Saul put for David to bring him. But it was a very dangerous proposition. It could have even been a deadly proposition. And it was an extremely messy proposition. David, here's the deal. Go out, and here's what my requirement is. David went out and doubled the requirement. Don't you know that was a mess on the coffee table? David demonstrated obedience over and over and over again. So here's this mighty man, this warrior, this young man that seems to have moved up in the troops, this young man that had killed multiple of the enemy, that kept doing what he was supposed to be doing, would even go over and would play for the king. And then this proven warrior, when it appears that there is a confrontation and there's going to be a fight between him and the current king, David runs and hides. Multiple times. Because God hadn't told him it's time yet. So David is obedient to run and hide. Something that I've noticed as I studied this is it seems like the idea of obedience rubs off on those around us. David was obedient to God in the way he handled things with Saul. Saul's son, Jonathan, was obedient as he actually went against his father to protect David. Michael, his daughter, helps hide David and helps him escape, even though her father is trying to kill him. Notice how those people that David gets close to are obedient also. See, we see in the life of David that safety and security is not necessarily guaranteed by obedience. We get the idea in our Christian walk today as we talk to people, if you'll just do what God tells you to do, and if you'll just be obedient to Him, He's going to take care of you. And the answer to that is yes, but not necessarily the way you and I are thinking. We won't be in this little isolated place where no harm can come to us. I think I've mentioned before, I've got a book on my shelf called The Book of Martyrs, and it's about that thick of people that were right in the middle of God's will who gave their lives for their faith. David's obedience demonstrates to us that we need to be obedient. But just because we're not safe and totally secure doesn't mean we're out of God's will. Often I hear people say, well, you just see what's going on. If God's blessing and everything's going great, you must be right where God wants you to be. It could be all going great because you're right where Satan wants you to be. Don't determine whether your obedience, whether you're being obedient by your circumstances. Obedience is determined by this. I look at God's word and he says to do this and I'm doing this and then I'm being obedient to him. Period. Okay? The circumstances will lie to you. You say, well, I come to church and I pray and I do this and I do this. And listen, sometimes we look at obedience in this, that I'm obedient in this. Now, I can be totally disobedient in all this stuff over here. And then we go, well, I'm doing this. Why won't God protect me? Well, he's talking about a lifestyle of obedience. He's talking about in all areas of our life. You don't get to say, hey, this area of my life trumps all these others. The obedience, and we were in a conference yesterday, and one of the statements that I heard one of the ministers make was the fact that there is salvation after salvation. I'm paraphrasing. In other words, we are saved, but we are being saved. There's the sanctification process that takes place. When I accept Christ and when he saves me and when he comes into my life, when I commit my life to him, that is salvation. But listen, that starts a process of sanctification. And if I'm looking at someone's life and there is no process of sanctification, then I think you probably missed it back here. Because forever in Scripture, it shows that we are in this process of being made more like Christ. And if I'm not more like Christ today than I was last week, I am either running from God as a believer or I was never a believer in the first place. And so David is showing us that we need to understand we are obedient even when things around us don't look that way. Just keep being obedient. As a matter of fact, I believe that we'll find over and over again, obedience to God puts us on the dangerous edge of protection, not in the middle of it. You say, well, was that fun? Well, I tell you what, by the rest of our lives, it seems to be. Anybody like to ride fast rides? Anybody ever watched a show of one of the roller coasters coming off the tracks? We want it to go fast, and we like it to go fast, but there's always that thing. You're on the edge right there. We do things all the time that put us on the edge, but when it comes to our Christian life, we enjoy it. I mean, it's an adrenaline rush. But then when we get in our Christian life, we want it to be quiet and comfortable and easy because I'm right in the middle of God's will. Now, sometimes being right in the middle of God's will means there's going to be some adrenaline. There's going to be some close calls. There's going to be some battles to fight. And he does have us protected, but it seems like we're right on the edge of the protection. David is a man that demonstrates a humble spirit. David is a man that demonstrates an obedience in his actions toward God. And David is also a man that demonstrates trusting faith in God. A trusting faith in God. Trust was vital for David because sight just wasn't there. What he saw, what his circumstances were, it looked like, David, you're wrong, you're in trouble, everything you're doing is going to lead to your death. You're going to die, dude. You're going to be killed. David, common wisdom says you're not in God's will. I mean, look what's happening. You're trying to comfort King Saul with your beautiful playing and singing. What'd you get? A spear thrown at you. Not by some novice, but by the king who is a trained, large warrior. He chunked a spear at David. Not once, but twice. Look at 1 Samuel 18:10. The next day, an evil spirit sent from God came powerfully on Saul, and he began to rave inside the palace. David was playing the lyre as usual, but Saul was holding a spear, and he threw it, thinking, I'll pin David to the wall. But David got away from him twice. Well, don't trust in the king. Don't trust in the government, David, because the head of the government's after you. Saul promoted David in rank in the army. Sounds great, right? But not because he was successful, he was, but because he hated David, and Saul was leveraging for a brutal death of David on the battlefield. In 1 Samuel 18, 17, it says, but Saul was thinking, I don't need to raise a hand against him. Let the hand of the Philistines be against him. Again, in verse 25, it says, actually, Saul intended to cause David's death at the hand of the Philistines. Now, take that and put that in the back of your mind and hang on to it, because that same action is going to show up later in David's life. He's going to take what evil Saul did and do the same thing not too long from now. But you see what's going on? Saul says, I'll just put him in a position where he will be killed. I'm going to put him on the front line. I'm going to put him out there so they'll take care of him and I don't have to deal with the consequences either way. Now look with me, if you will, because David kept winning. God kept keeping him right on the edge of protection. 1 Samuel 19, verses 1 through 10, Saul ordered his son Jonathan and all his servants to kill David. But Saul's son Jonathan liked David very much, so he told him, my father Saul intends to kill you. Be on guard in the morning. Hide in a secret place and stay there. I'll go out and I'll stand beside my father in the field where you are and talk to him about you. When I see what he says, I'll tell you. Jonathan spoke well of David to his father Saul. He said to him, the king should not sin against his servant David. He hasn't sinned against you. In fact, his actions have been a great advantage to you. He took his life in his hands when he struck down the Philistine, and the Lord brought about a great victory for Israel. You saw it and rejoiced, and so why would you sin against innocent blood by killing David for no reason? Saul listened to Jonathan's advice and swore an oath. As surely as the Lord lives, David will not be killed. So Jonathan summoned David and told him all these words. And then Jonathan brought David to Saul, and he served him as he did before. When war broke out again, David went out and fought against the Philistines. He defeated them with such a great force that they fled from him. Now an evil spirit sent from the Lord came to Saul as he was sitting in his palace holding a spear. David was playing the lyre, and Saul tried to pin David to the wall with the spear. As the spear struck the wall, David eluded Saul, ran away, and escaped that night. And then we know, we're going to look at the rest of the story next week. What a trusting person. I mean, if somebody had thrown a spear at me twice, I don't think I would have gone back for the next round. But Jonathan spoke to Saul. Saul says, man, I promise, I make an oath. Be careful. You see, what I see here is that we've got to be careful of who we put our trust in. If we look at the rest of verse 19 and all of chapter 19 and all of chapter 20, it describes a persistence of Saul pursuing David literally for his head. Much of David's protection came through God using other people to protect him. Jonathan and Michael lived for it too. Sure, David was humble. Yes, he was obedient, but that is not enough. You see, Jonathan and Michael and many others were simply human beings, and they were all very capable of turning on David. Saul did. Tell him to come back. All's forgiven. We'll be okay. You see, people are very capable of realigning their loyalties. So for David to put his trust in friendship and his trust in the love of humans, those that seemed to love him, was risky at best and deadly at worst. Now, does that mean we're not to have friends? That's not what I'm saying. Does that mean we're not to trust people? That's not what I'm saying. But ultimately, my trust must be in the Lord, not in other people. He had to trust God to provide, sometimes supernaturally and sometimes through other people. But make no mistake, David's trust and his faith was in God. Not in a slingshot, not in personal abilities, not in future position, not in the family he was married into. His faith was in God and God alone. His faith in God had to override his vision of the circumstances that he found himself in. So what do we do? What do we leave here with? Number one, we are to strive to be in the center of the will of God. That ought to be our desire, right where God wants me to be. Number two, it's a matter of the heart. We need to be men and women with hearts that are after the heart of God and that are turned toward God and committed to Him. Number three, if we get one and two right, we'll be humble in spirit. We'll be obedient in action, and we'll be trusting in our faith. With all that said, we find ourselves in difficult positions. Positions that we didn't ask for. Remember, there was no resume turned in by David for king. They weren't taking resumes. David didn't say, toss my name in with my brothers. Samuel came and said, not this one, not this one, not this one, and went on and then said, this one. God chose him. David didn't ask for it. He was content with tending the sheep, but he responded to God's call on his life. God calls us, and we need to be quick to respond to his call, but we do it with humility, we do it with obedience, and we do it with faith, trusting in God. Being for God and living for God and serving for God will place us in precarious situations. It will place us on the edge of protection. As a matter of fact, did you realize how many times, I think it two or three times today, and if we had read the entire passage, it would have said it more. How many times it said, now an evil spirit sent from the Lord came upon Saul. It wasn't just that Saul was just a bad dude. God was causing him to be angry. Wait a minute. God is intentionally putting David in a place. Now, God is intentionally bringing this evil spirit upon Saul because of his sin. But guess what? It gets splashed all over David. David's circumstances are what they are because of God's reaction to Saul's sin. But David was right in the middle of God's will. So we have to understand this, that the edge position of protection could well be the circumstances that causes us to remain humble, to remain obedient, and to remain operating in faith in God, because otherwise I'm sunk. Otherwise I'm dead. So I want to ask you today, where's God have you? Where are you? Are you in the middle of His will? Do you know that because of what the Bible says? Because that's the only way you really know. Is that your heart's desire? I hope it is. Because let me tell you, in the middle of God's will, even on the edge of protection, if you're in the middle of God's will, is the safest place you can be. Might not look like it, might not feel like it, but you're right where God wants you to be. Humility, obedience, faith in God is what's required. What does He want you to do? What is His calling on your life? What is your answer? If He's Lord, the answer has to be yes.